If we find an Earth-like planet, a rocky planet, orbiting a distant star, how might we go about looking for the presence of life on that planet? Well, the approach we take is to look for biosignatures, signatures of life on those planets. We've already seen that a very large number of exoplanets have been discovered in recent years. This is a graph up to 2012 showing you the number of planets and the different methods that have been used to find them that we've already looked at a previous lecture, and the numbers of planets that have been discovered year by year. There's an increasing number of planets being discovered, and more recently, Earth-like planets within the habitable zone of a star, rocky planets, rocky terrestrial-type planets. What signs of life could we look for in these exoplanetary atmospheres? Well, let's just have a look at the Earth and think about how we might detect life here. Well, we've already seen that life produces oxygen. Photosynthesis produces oxygen. That's one signature of life. Biology can also produce methane, which is another signature of life. But what's interesting about the Earth is that oxygen coexists with methane. And in normal chemical reactions, you'd expect the methane to be consumed by oxygen. So the coexistence of oxygen and methane in a planetary atmosphere out of equilibrium with what we'd expect from normal chemical processes is an indication there's life on our planet. So we could look for oxygen and methane coexisting in an exoplanetary atmosphere as a signature of life. Another signature we could look for is ozone. Ozone is produced by oxygen. Oxygen reacts with sunlight in the upper atmosphere and produces this gas that screens out ultraviolet radiation on our planet. But it turns out that ozone also has a very strong signature in the light given off by a planet. So we could use oxygen as a possible signature of life, but also ozone, the gas that's produced from it. As well as looking at gases in the atmosphere, we could also try and directly detect biology on the surface of a planet. Vegetation on our own planet gives a very detectable signature because it reflects infrared light. We'll look at this in more detail later, but if we look at the infrared light given off by a planet, we could plausibly detect vegetation-like life on the surface of an extrasolar planet, just as we can detect vegetation on the surface of the Earth by looking at the infrared radiation it gives off by satellites orbiting the Earth. We have to be very careful about these biosignatures, though, because they're not always biologically produced. For example, oxygen can be produced in a planetary atmosphere by non-biological processes. The atmosphere of Mars, for instance, contains about 0.14% oxygen, and this is produced by carbon dioxide in the Martian atmosphere reacting with sunlight in the atmosphere and producing oxygen. But it's true to say that you can't really get very high concentrations of oxygen in an atmosphere by non-biological processes, particularly on a planet where there's liquid water. On our own planet, with 21% oxygen, that level of oxygen is really a very strong indication of life. You can't get that level of oxygen on a planet where there's no life. But what about planets that are anoxic, that have very low concentrations of oxygen? In earlier lectures, we saw that that was the case for early Earth. There were very low concentrations of oxygen, but we know there was life on the planet. Well, we could look for methane. Methane is produced by microorganisms in oxygen-free environments, but the problem is that methane can be produced by non-biological processes, so it really isn't a definitive biosignature of life. Scientists have thought about looking for other types of gases that could be signatures of life in anoxic atmospheres. For example, ethane, nitrous oxide, even organic sulfur and other compounds could work as biosignatures in oxygen-free atmospheres, in anoxic atmospheres. We know very little about these materials and how they might be used as biosignatures, so it's an ongoing field of investigation for astrobiologists to look at potential biosignatures that could be used on planets with different compositions than the composition of the atmosphere of present-day Earth. Putting all this data into context, biosignatures are not proof of life in their own right. We have much more confidence if there is evidence for water vapor or liquid water on the surface of a planet, if the temperature of the planet is within the range expected for complex carbon compounds, and if there are other gases there that are required for life to do metabolic processes, for example, carbon dioxide used in photosynthesis. So what we really want to see is gases associated with biosignatures along with the other criteria for habitability that we've met in previous lectures. We want to find a habitable planet that also has these biosignatures. What would happen if we found a habitable planet around a star, but there were no atmospheric signs of life? Well, that's more difficult to interpret. There might be some reasons for that. For example, there might be life on that planet, but we just can't see it. There isn't enough of it for us to see a biosignature or to detect it directly on the planetary surface. We could be looking for the wrong thing. Maybe we found a planet that's habitable and happens to have life as we don't know it. Maybe it's doing metabolic processes that we simply can't detect because we're not looking for the right biosignature. Maybe life on that planet is in the subsurface and it's not producing enough gases or changing the surface of the planet to make itself detectable. Or maybe the planet just has no life. It's habitable, yet uninhabited. It could be that there's been no origin of life on that planet. So although conditions are suitable for life, there's no life that has originated there in order to be able to make use of these conditions to grow, evolve, and proliferate on that planetary surface. So what have we learned in this lecture? Well, we've learned that the Earth's atmospheric composition is dependent on biologically mediated processes such as photosynthesis. And these biosignatures could provide a tool to remotely detect these processes in other planetary environments, including extrasolar atmospheres. We've learned that important biosignatures include the infrared reflectance signal of vegetation, but also gases in a non-equilibrium state, such as oxygen with methane, for example. And we've also learned that there are other types of compounds, maybe organic sulfur compounds, nitrous oxide, and other gases that might be used to detect life in extrasolar planets. We've learned that also due to interference from abiotic factors, biosignatures should be interpreted with some caution. Some gases, such as oxygen, can be produced by non-biological processes. So we really have to consider the chemistry of extrasolar planetary surfaces and atmospheres to understand whether those gases are biological or whether they could be produced by non-biological processes. We've learned that the availability of liquid water, a suitable temperature regime, and other gases such as carbon dioxide must also be considered within our assessment of a planet as possibly harbouring life. We need to see conditions for habitability. But we've also thought about the possibility that if we detect no signs of biological processes in a given atmosphere, life might still be present on that planet, just not to the extent that makes itself detectable, or maybe in a form that makes it undetectable using the assumptions that we've made already.